All right, everybody, welcome back to Generating Income in Your Portfolio. My name is Mike Fairborn. Great to have you here for Schwab Coaching, folks. Today, I want to talk about a key tool for evaluating REITs on thinkorswim, one that you might not have seen before, but it's a great way to get a sense of how those REITs have been performing, especially relative to other REITs. So I will look forward to going through that with you. It's nice to be here again. As I said, by the way, folks, you can join me on Twitter. Well, X, formerly Twitter. There's my handle right there, just Mike Fairborn CS. Great to have you all in the chat today. I'm joined in the chat by Cameron May. Follow Cam on X as well, just Cameron May CS as well. Let's go ahead and dive on into this. Excited to get into this tool and show you what thinkorswim has got in relationship to REITs. So let's get started with some disclosure items here. Please be mindful of the following points as we go through this, as we look at this. So information here is for general information purposes only and should not be considered an individualized recommendation or endorsement of any security strategy or account or investment strategy or account type. With that, too, the paper money application is for educational purposes only as well. Now, investing does involve risks, including the loss of principal. Past performance of any security or strategy does not guarantee future results or success either. Please keep that in mind. All right, let's continue on. One final slide here. We'll dive on into this. Risk of REITs are similar to those associated with direct ownership in real estate, such as changes in real estate values and property taxes, interest rates, cash flow of underlying real estate assets, supply and demand, and the management skill and credit worthiness of the issuer. Okay, with that too, just a final point here, noting that there are risks associated with dividend paying stocks, including, but not limited to the risk that those stocks may reduce or stop paying dividends in the future. So please keep those points in mind. Again, great to have you here in the chat. As we're just getting started here, folks, but let's move to our agenda here, get going, and there we go. So within this class, we do talk about, you know, what is income generation. We look across a few different broad categories. We'll take a look at those in just a moment. This is where we look for different types of income generation specifically. Now, we have been talking a lot about dividend paying stocks. Absolutely true. We've been looking at recently some options as well. Covered calls and short puts today. Like I said, it's a totally unique category. It is REITs. I do have some examples to look at as we do go through some of the unique tools really on thinkorswim as we go through this. So just a quick point, there are the methods of income generation listed right there. You can see under REITs, as I just mentioned, there are a few different categories here: commercial, residential, healthcare, industrial, mortgage. Look forward to going through those with you in just a moment. First, let's start off with just a broad market discussion, just quickly reviewing the market, seeing how we've been doing on the day here. I'll pull this back a little bit and kind of bring that in a bit. Yeah, we're at 1 year already, so that's perfect. Well, we did get above our 4,800 level, as you can see right there on the SPX. We've broken above this level. Now, it is interesting to note, and obviously this can change over periods of time, but some technicians have noted that what you'll see with breakouts, they're generally only successful. It's around 30% of the time a breakout. In other words, when a breakout occurs and prices just flat out just run higher. So it's not always the most, you know, common outcome for just a breakout and a higher above, let's say a resistance point. In fact, you see some evidence of that right over here. When we came over here, we actually touched off that high and then went back down. There was a similar high there. We kind of came back down again. So so far we have broken out. I think the NASDAQ's maybe a day ahead of this, but there is the possibility too. What does frequently happen is a pullback here to kind of support around the 4,800 level, resting on those prior highs. We'll see what does unfold there. It had been interesting, I must say, just to watch kind of the dynamics in terms of the momentum. Momentum was a little bit weak, as you can see, just judging, basing it upon the RSI. We had a high point here on the RSI, but we made a slightly higher high in price over here. We made a lower high on the RSI. We actually came up and made even a slightly higher high above the prior high on price, but yet here we are again. We made it a lower high. What's interesting is we did bounce back. You can get that with an RSI move as long as it's strong enough and you get enough price momentum. And I'm talking higher closes from one day to the next. It can really influence that the price going higher. A quick review of the NASDAQ 100 just to see what we've got there. Oh, let's get that off the screen. There we go. Take a look at the NDX specifically. It may have been a day earlier. I'm not sure. It was very close to a breakout right here on this day. We're still extending higher on the NASDAQ, really being led by many of the semiconductor type stocks. You got Intel, which did have a day today. There is earnings coming up on some of these as well. We are in the midst of earnings season, clearly. It may have been NVIDIA that really helped get us above that 500 quite early. As you can see over here, it was a big break and we extended higher. Part of the NASDAQ 100 as well as the S&P 500, you can see right there. Now, here is the Russell. Just a quick note on the Russell. Took a look at this yesterday in the class. I thought it was important to point out that we do have some strong trends. In fact, clear, you call it bull markets, right, in the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ. But when we look at the Russell, the small cap stocks, it's a unique environment. They really haven't participated the same way as those companies in the S&P 500, some of those larger global companies. Remember, we're looking at more small cap and even micro cap companies in the Russell 2000. Let me just extend this back 10 years to kind of show you what I'm talking about. There's your pullback right here. So, that's the 2021 highs, much like we saw with the S&P 500 before there was a pretty weak year in 2022. We came all the way down here. Folks, we're still just kind of bouncing around, testing near prior highs, not really breaking back up above and holding those prior highs. So we're kind of in a bit of, it's bear market-ish in a sense that we have been down and kind of in a sideways channel, have yet to be able to break out, but clearly higher highs, both NASDAQ and S&P 500. I'll just pull up a 10-year on each of these so you can see it. So, right, that same consolidation, we didn't hold. We had a good year last year, continuing to break out this year, as well as the NASDAQ, even stronger. Oh, what is that? Oh, defaulted to a symbol I had never seen before. There you go, but there you have it. So that's a pretty big 2022 pullback. 2023, I should say. It was 2023, a big, strong rally to the upside. This was 2023, last year, for the S&P 500 index that it also rose higher with the Russell did not participate. So it's an interesting kind of a market and something to just be mindful of is if you are in the market, you're looking for companies, what companies out there might be strong with the underlying index? Well, collectively, many companies within the S&P 500, because it's breaking higher as well as the NASDAQ. So just some things to keep in mind there. Quick note too, anytime you're in here, just go into the Market Watch tab. I have earnings selected over on the left-hand side, and you can see this is the NASDAQ 100 I have selected right here, but just a great way to see what earnings you've got in store upcoming for the week. We can expand this out too. Just click on the wheel to the right. By the way, that's a filter in so many different areas of thinkorswim. Anytime you see that, that wheel, and many times it is for different securities too. I'm just going to go down under public folders. There's the 500 right there. Many more companies, so much so that we can't even fill the box. We can overfill the box. In this case, 24 and 26, it appears, companies. If you click on it, though, on that day, it will tell you what's upcoming. So just a couple of quick notes there. We are in the midst of earnings season, so that I think it's an important thing to keep in mind. We'll see that from some of the REITs that we'll be looking at as well today. But welcome to all of you joining us again. Oh, let's see. Bob had a question just initially. Mike, hard to see the drop in ADM coming. Atypical. How do you screen for that accounting issue? Bob, I'm going to have to get back to you on that one. Yeah, that's interesting for ADM. Just specifically, big picture, ADM, a fairly large pullback, but accounting issues. And by the way, anytime you want to see any indication of that, just go to the news and you can find information specifically on that. Actually, I did send a bit of a tweet out on that today. It's a little side note there. But yeah, some of those are very tricky. Remember, ADM and many of those companies are dividend aristocrats. They've been raising dividends for over 25 years straight. So it is unusual to kind of see that. But it's a good reminder, isn't it? There's not a lot of protection against potential accounting issues. Here's a company that's been able to raise the dividend. That's generally an indication that things have been going fairly well with the company. I mean, they might have additional funds, in other words, to continue to raise that dividend. And the fact that maybe there were some issues there, I did see the CFO resign. So it's, you've got to be mindful of that. Okay. Well, great to have you all here. Let's dive on into a few areas just to get started here a little bit into this. Looking at really a key evaluating tool was what we want to discuss here for REITs, evaluating REITs on thinkorswim. But before we even get there, let's pull up the left-hand sidebar here and take a look at some of the gadgets. I just want to put in over here into our scratch pads some notes as we get going along. I do like to put it all in one on one screen as we go through this here. When you are looking at REITs, now what are REITs, right? REITs, real estate investment trusts. And what do? Well, they invest in a lot of different categories within the market. In fact, an interesting way to do that, you can go over here right into the Market Watch tab. We'll go into quotes up top. I'm going to search in the dropdown. I am going to go into, let's see, we have a whole section here. If anytime you wanted to just see REITs by themselves. I'm missing it right there. There we go. Okay, so we go. I'm sorry. There we go. REITs. So there's a whole category of REITs that you can list, but notice there are a number of REITs listed in here. Normally, this would be across a number of different categories. In fact, I'm going to pull this up right now just to show you and highlight this. In fact, I'm going to take a couple of these out. We'll go full screen here just to kind of highlight this for now. But specifically, if I click in one of these categories, in fact, I'll click here to add one in up top. I'm looking for sub-industries. There's a sub-industry right there at the bottom. We'll pull it up to the top. And there we go. One more up. Right next to the description. This will tell us all of the different types of REITs. There are diversified REITs. Those REITs that, and you know, many of these are just investing. They're purchasing land specifically around different types of sort of broader products. They might be down here, for example, retail REITs, retail outlet malls. Malls would be a big one. It could just be a retail store as well. You've got single family residences. These are businesses that are purchasing just that, single family residences, and they're renting that out to these individuals. The company is collecting that income. And then based upon what they collect, this is an interesting side note here too. I mean, it's actually an important element of this. But REITs themselves, and these are equity REITs referring to as now those that are investing in some of these key areas. We're looking at as opposed to the broader category of, let's say, mortgage REITs. Those REITs, let me see, just go down a little bit here. There we go. Those REITs, you know, and really across the board REITs, 90% of the money that they receive in is income they have to pay out to shareholders, which is an interesting kind of a category, right? In terms of what we can look at for investors, if they're paying out 90% of their income, well, in a lot of ways, if the company is growing, we can kind of see that if the dividend yield or just the dividend payments are being made, if they're going higher over time, it's a sense that the company is oftentimes bringing in more income too. So they pay out 90% of their income to shareholders. 90% income. Okay. Paid to shareholders. That is one of the deals with a REIT. That's one of the requirements. It used to be 95% requirement. Imagine that, having to run your business with just 5% less. I mean, 5% to run the whole thing and to keep it growing. That's really quite small. But with that, you can get some really interesting insight. If the dividends are growing, it's payments out to shareholders, gives you a sense that, yeah, they're bringing in additional income streams too, or that income is rising. So we're going to dive into that in just a second. But so that's just kind of a general sense of REITs. Now, what I wanted to do is highlight for you a couple of areas that investors are looking at in terms of the goals they may have in place. Let me just push this up a little. There we go. So in terms of goals, so goals specifically, you might broadly be thinking of the goals if you're looking at a REIT. And there are, like, for example, one key category would be like an income seeker. Now, the income seeker is just looking for a higher dividend yield. Okay, and here are some of the yields. I'll just pull these over to the left right now, that column. You get a sense of some of those yields, but they want to have that stability of income. They want cash flows, or what's known as funds from operations, to be rather steady and stable, okay, over a period of time. But they want a dividend yield that might be, you know, somewhat competitive in the market, maybe whatever that is. A lot of times investors will look at the 3% and higher number. You see many of these really, really quite high. A quick note, notice many of these mortgage REITs, which we're not going to talk about, they invest in different mortgages. So what they do is they take the funds, shareholders are investing in the company takes the funds and they invest in other mortgages. So be mindful of that. Those are really, really high rates and they're actually very, very volatile. We're not going to be talking about those today. That's a different kind of a discussion we'll have specifically. So what I wanted to do is talk about that. So the income seeker, they want that in the stable, high dividend, a higher dividend, which is a lot of times what you get with REITs, higher yields, plus stability. Okay. Now with that, there is something I wanted to note here for you. If we're going to go in that area as an income seeker, Schwab.com has a really great tool. I'm going to pull it up right over here off of Schwab specifically. And if we were to look at a specific REIT, in fact, let's just go over here. We'll pull it up. Pull up just any symbol. Here's AMT, American Tower. This company buys land. A lot of times just in areas that are not being used, and they put cell towers on it and they rent out that land and oftentimes just the tower itself to other cellular service providers. So you can see it's still part of a land ownership process, right? With that, even though it is quite unique. Okay. With that, let's go over here and just show you. Let's see, I had it. Oh, there it is. Okay. So if I go into AMT here, what you can do on Schwab, this is a really cool tool. Scroll on down to dividends and just click on show more. So as soon as you see dividends there, we'll give you a sense of those dividends being paid. If you click on show more, it does give at the bottom. Look at this. This is great. This is actually a 10-year history of those dividends. Right here. So here's 2023 dividends right there. This is broken down into the, let's see, the months. Each month for 2023 to the end that they've, you know, announced or had in place in terms of the dividend payments. But you can see that long history of dividends here, those payments increasing over a period of time. And that could be something that investors could look at right off of Schwab.com to give them a sense of what is the history of those dividends. You know, those dividend payments look like specifically. So there it is again, though. Remember, you have to go in under dividends and you have to click on show more right there. So scroll into that, find your symbol up top, just below chart and news. There you have it. Click on it again and it'll be right there. By the way, it's really cool because it does give you a sense of the calendar, your dividend payments by X date too. It's got these numbers listed right here. This doesn't quite go back as far as what you're seeing down below here. This goes back to 2014. I'm seeing 2016 here and higher, but you can see it climbing and climbing. And that could be a really interesting indication. I mean, you wouldn't necessarily have to go back. I mean, you can go back 10 years, but that's a lot of data right there, right off top, just to see too what those annual payments were looking like. So a really great tool there, specifically for those individuals that were focused in on, you know, the higher yields and stability, kind of like income type seekers. Okay. Now the other side of that though is the stability, and that is the cash flow. I'm going to talk about that in just a second, but just looking at one other type of investor here, and what they're going to be doing is kind of the total return. And what they're looking for is both a combination of yields plus capital appreciation. Stock price moves going higher. Okay. The price of the stock too, which can really, really enhance a return, but that is more focused on the cash flow. Now, specifically when we're talking about REITs, the cash flow from a REIT perspective, you're going to see this term FFO, and that stands for funds from operations. Okay. And that simply is just really, it's defined as the cash flow from REIT or real estate investment trust companies. And there are certain ways to adjust for it. It's very, very similar to cash flow right off of the cash flow statement. I want to pull up that a little bit in Schwab.com as well and just kind of show you that. There's one other category and then we're done. but it's really, these are the key points. These are how REITs are valued down below. So I need to put this in here. Valued but tracked. There are valuation metrics that are tied in to funds from operations and AFFO, adjusted funds from operations. But you know, when we're looking at REIT performance, you know, company performance, it's really tied into funds from operations, and you'll see that across the board. Analysts, that's what they use. But the good thing is we don't have funds from operations specifically, but we do have cash flow on thinkorswim. It's so nice. We can actually scan for it. We're going to lead into that in just a second here. The last one is AFFO. And that is adjusted funds from operations. I'll just put operations right there. Now, the difference there is it is cash flow that the company is collecting, but they're also accounting for capital expenditures to run the business. And so what can we use there? We can use free cash flow as a means. And that's where we're ultimately going to be at today. And because we can scan for that on the thinkorswim platform as well. But looking at cash flow and that growth rates of cash flow can really, really be informative to an investor. Because is that growing over time, even after they've had to adjust for capital appreciation and expenses to run the business? So it's the same thing as cash flow. I'll put the whole thing down here. Cash flow. But we're subtracting out expenses, expenditures, and specifically capital expenditures. Okay. So those are the key points right there I wanted to highlight. Funds from operations and adjusted funds from operations. That's what we want to see. Now, a quick note just to tie into this. If we're looking at funds from operations that are going higher, or specifically adjusted funds from operations, if they are going up, okay, it's increasing. The company's getting more income. We talked about the income paid out to shareholders at a 90% clip. There's kind of a bit of a two-way street here, a little bit of a wheel, so to speak, going on. And a lot of times, if that income is increasing, if we see those dividend payments increasing, that's also a sign that the company has that free cash flow to spend to increase. And by, like we said, though, there's that requirement to do so. You can kind of see it from both sides. Didn't mean that for that to be a minus right there. I should just highlight there's no pluses and minuses. They're both just, they can kind of work off of each other a little bit. So you can kind of see it from both angles. So I want to show you that real quick, because in Schwab, we can find the financial statements. So I'm going to go back here. Let's go back one. So all I'm at right now still, I'm just in the same place. Folks, it's so nice because you can find everything too in the same place over here. Just research and research tools. That's really where you get really the largest access to all the fundamental tools right here. Let's scroll down because we're still on a REIT. But there are the statements right there, the financial statements. I want to do this. I'm going to go ahead and click on the cash flow statement. And there is cash flow, or let's see, total cash flow from operations. Now, if you didn't see my class yesterday, these financial statements are interesting. They go from right to left. Okay, so you notice over here in the past, over to the present, to 2022, that's the trend. It's going from right to left. And by the way, the annual trend can throw you off a little bit too if you don't know that, because notice the annual trend is going, you're reading it this way. We're so used to reading stock charts. I know I am. I mean, I had to remind myself, hey, be careful as you look at this, right? Because that's a little bit different. You do get a trend of the company here, though. You can see that right there, okay? But it is going from right to left. Keep that in mind. I'm going to click on Show More right down here, because these are really cool tools on Schwab as well. But we got to go back into the cash flow statement, and we can go into annuals, fine, but there's a detailed summary. Perfect. So this is where we're at. So this is cash flow from operations, and that's really the cash flow that we're looking at, or CFO, as it's sometimes called. What does the total cash from operations look like? Again, 2018 to 2022. Not everybody does it this way. There are some that do, but we're going in this direction. Okay, so has it been stable? Would you say it's been somewhat stable? Well, I mean, we've been bouncing around. I think, yeah, those are, you know, right in the 3,000 to 4,000 range. This is adjusted, I believe, into the millions category, but just to kind of read it as it is right there. And there is your total cash flow. You can see that trend right there. It has moved around a little bit, but the funds from adjusted funds from operations does one thing. And I really love this here, because right off the cash flow statement, we can get a sense of what something very close to the adjusted funds from operations are, and analysts will use this. There's a lot of work on this, that they will use cash flow from operations. This line we're seeing right here, as well as free cash flow by subtracting out capital expenditures. It's all right there. So basically what I'm going to do is just highlight this and show you the free cash flow for this company. You would take this number. Oh, I'm sorry. I've got to do that over here. Here we go. We take this number. We're subtracting, we take this number and we're subtracting it out. So free cash flow would be right there. You see that? So we're taking the 37, we're minusing out the 3748, we're minusing out the 913. That gives us free cash flow. And that is akin, it's not exactly the same, but like I said, analysts and investors will use this to adjusted funds from operations. Okay. Whereas up top here, this is just the FFO. We're just looking at cash flow. And that growth is headed this way or not into the future, right? It's this way. Got to remember not to go this way like a lot of, I think financial statements that are reported go from left to right. So just be mindful that it's headed up this way. But that is adjusted funds from operations. We're just taking that cash flow, minusing out what they refer to as CapEx. And that CapEx, again, is the required expense to keep the business functioning, to keep that business going forward. Think about it. They have to build new buildings if they want to ultimately, at some point in time, try to bring in more income. Well, that's a cap expense, right, in terms of this business, capital expenditure. So we still want to see adjusted funds from operations going higher. Okay, now I'm going to take a look before we dive into kind of the core of this, and we'll set this up for you so you can see what we've got going. Let me just go back and hit some questions here. All right, so we've got, there was one coming through here. Let's see, Bernard. Notice you'll be talking about fundamental scan in the future. Can you give the 7 fundamentals for growth stock search in order for their importance when you are limited? I'd be happy to try to. Yeah, we can look at something like that, Bernard. Sure. In fact, we could do something like that. In fact, I love topic requests as well in the chat. It's a great way to let me know what you guys are looking at. So definitely throw those in. I do go through and read through all those comments. So appreciate that. Yep. Be happy to. That might be have to go on a different session there, Bernard, though, as we go through this. I'm kind of limited in the time that I've got today to present, but thank you for that very much. And I think Cam's got the other one. Perfect. We're all set. Okay. Well, let's do it. I'm going to go ahead and show you scan over here, because I mentioned a key thing here is a very unique tool on thinkorswim to evaluate REITs. In fact, we've got free cash flow over here. I can run that free cash flow right in this section down below. Now, I'm getting just a little bit ahead of myself, but I wanted to just make that connection. There's the free cash flow. And by the way, I don't know if you like to do it this way. I put it back from left to right. So this is in the past, and this is going into the future, into the current annual right now. Okay. What I've done, first things first, very important. You've got to get this part right before we get to the rest. We have to do this. We've got to scan in the REITs. Okay. So to scan in the REITs, we just, it's very similar to the Market Watch tab. Click in the scan down, go to your public folder, and you'll find REITs in there. There are two ways to do this, but that's one of the quickest ways you can go into REITs. You can also go into the industry right here, over here. I'll selecting all real estate, but there you go. I'm just going to show you there are a couple of ways. So, like there is in many cases on thinkorswim, but I've selected REITs. We're scanning in REITs, real estate investment trust. Now, up top, I have a couple of filters I put in here, three to be exact. What I've done, first up, is I've got the yield on the stock. So I think many people might be looking at a 2% or greater yield, depending upon where you might fall. Like we said over here, there are income seekers. Now, they might be looking at higher yields. And folks, that would take them to the higher side, the max side, which is I had about 9%. I'm still in the single digits. If you go outside the single digits, we're going to be talking about mortgage REITs. They're very volatile. It's a different, well, it's a different creature altogether. So we got to be very careful with that. But there are the higher yields or just, you know, but total return, maybe they might have lower yields in the 2% range. So it could be in terms of goals, what you might be looking at on either one of those two. But I've set it here to avoid mortgage REITs on the max right there. There's 9%. Okay. Now, I did put a PE ratio in here because one thing is that when we're talking about REITs, it's not the same as stocks, obviously. There are differences. There's different ways to analyze a REIT versus a stock for sure. There are different, regulations with REITs, as we talked about, but if they're not making earnings, if they don't have a PE ratio of at least one, then that can be obviously a really interesting sign, a good sign that they're probably not profitable businesses on the free cash flow side too. It's probably a pretty clear connection between the two. So I've put that there, okay, as one. This is a filtering process up top. Now, the only other filter I put in here was the free cash flow on the current. All I want it to be is positive here. That's it. Because I want to show you down below what we're looking for. We're looking for the consistency, the growth, not just of free cash flow, right? Very, very difficult to get a free cash flow. If free cash flow is not positive, so hard to get adjusted funds from operations to be positive. In other words, you've got to have, in so many cases, solid free cash flow to account for that capital expenditure to get a positive AFFO. So we've kind of progressed to that in our search, although we could put cash flow in here as well. I've just put in, remember our alternative here, which is the free cash flow per share. That's what we're looking at. We're looking at growth over that period of time, at least the last 3 years, okay? And this is a current free cash flow, but it's really looking at really everything through 2023 is how that stands. In fact, let's do this. When I increase the font size, one of the downsides of that is that it scrunches everything up. But you can see we'll get the numbers in there, 2021 right there, and then this is 2022. I'm fine with the others getting scrunched for now, although these are interesting data points too. I was going to highlight, but looking specifically at the trend of the fundamental growth as it connects to free cash flow, we're looking to see that across the board. What does that growth look like? if that growth can be strong, you've got a history of it. We can review Schwab, as I mentioned, just to see what the other side looks like. So we can see and confirm that dividends are increasing, right? Let's pull it up. Remember, we looked over here. Oh, I'm going to move away from our financial statements for a second. Scoot back up here. And there are dividends right there. Let's click on show more. Let's scoot it on down. Oh, are you going to update for me? I don't know. Yes. Okay. So on one side, what are we looking at? Dividend growth increasing over a period of time, whatever company we've got. On the other side, we're looking at behind the scenes, under the trunk, so to speak, right? How's the actual company doing? You know, we know there's that relationship between the 90% payout, but can we also see it on an adjusted funds from operation basis too? Okay, so that's kind of a couple of quick checkpoints to look at. So we're looking for that continuous growth over here. Now, what I did is I came up top here, and this is so cool. You can actually export this to a Microsoft Excel file, which I did. So I posted that. I put it over here. I'm kind of just taking a step forward into this, but. And let me expand this so you can see it. But what I wanted to do, I just did a quick Excel code just to tell me, there's your code right there, just to tell me if it's climbing or not climbing. In other words, climbing by definition is that you have to have D4 greater than C4. In other words, D's got to be greater than C. And by the way, C has to be greater than B. If so, it just says climbing. And if not, it says nothing. It just leaves it blank. And so this is a way to kind of see, hey, what's growing out there? And with that, finally, we can take a look at, last but not least, the stock trend. How does that look? I know many of you are very, very good at stocks and piecing that all together, but that's kind of the correlation we're looking at. All right. By the way, great to have you here, Melody, Ramal, Yang, Debbie, and others. Scott, nice to have you on board, folks. Any questions you've got, great time to throw them in right now, because all I'm going to do is sort these out. We're going to look for some stocks here in terms of an example trade within our portfolio. Okay, so let's take off my squiggly line. And what I'm going to do is just arrange this based on if it's climbing or not. And all I want to simply do is highlight these columns. Run it on down. I don't think I got the full 80 in there. I think I just took out 50, but that's okay. This will give us a sense of what we're looking at. In fact, a few of the companies we can take a look at that have been trending are in here. Well, I was just going to show you can sort it. Maybe we don't even need to sort it, but if you go up top, you can sort this too. So this is not really an Excel class at all. In fact, it's not an Excel class, but you can sort by column F. And what's column F? Well, A to Z. I think if I just, choose A to Z, it should just, okay. It puts them at the bottom. That's okay. Z to A, whatever the case is, you can see what we're doing is we're just putting the ones that are increasing all together, and that's just fine. So these are those companies. Now, as a final bonus or twist here, I'm going to take the ones that are growing right now, in terms of free cash flow, I'm going to copy it. Just like this, and I'm going to import it back over to thinkorswim. I know there are a few steps here, but I did want to take advantage, at least show you, you know, what we do have available here. There's a lot of great things. Let me just minimize that for now. I'm going to take it to our watch list. I'm going to go in here. I am going to create a watch list, and we'll just call it climbing REITs. Based upon what we had there. Now, I am going to import it because remember, I did hit copy. So because I hit copy, I can now paste. And that just saves quite a bit of time. You know, if you're getting familiar with thinkorswim, it can be quite helpful. So there you go. And boom, climbing REITs, you've got it right there. So let's do this. I'm going to link these together. Red. And we'll scoot on over here. And we can go through and take a look at some of these. And now REITs, not all of the REITs have been strong. In fact, there have been some clearly more than others. But look at this. I can scan through so quickly. By the way, this is on a weekly basis. I'm going to go back to a daily, maybe put on a couple years worth of data so we can do a screen on these and just see what's going on. They have recently come off their lows. There have been some potential indications of, discussions in terms of interest rates maybe dipping into the future, some cutbacks on interest rates. Many of these companies are heavily capitalized, so they would stand to benefit if, let's say, out there in the market, interest rates are lower on some of the debt that they maybe have not signed in for a longer period of time. Okay. In other words, it's not long-term debt fixed. It might be variable rate debt. Okay. So going down through here and taking a look, and by the way, you have really good information on this too. You're seeing a few of these companies doing exactly this. They're breaking above prior highs and just kind of resting there after making higher lows. Now, as we explore this company here, let's just take a look at it. Notice too that money flow is breaking out. You had some strength, momentum-wise, breaking above there, a little bit of consolidation. So a little bit of movement potentially around interest rates changing. And that can impact these companies. But again, there's a lot more to it than that. You've got to look inside the company. Again, the groups of companies we're looking at here were climbing, right? They were climbing across the board. And so REITs had been down, but many of them have just barely started to change a trend. So I thought it was an interesting discussion to get into. We've had some pretty big spikes here. You can see, I'm going to go through actually all the ones here. That one really shot up high, HOST. I don't know if we have an explanation. Oh, we do. Cool. We just don't have we're getting some fundamental data coming in now. Some of that fundamental data has been missing. Perfect. We're getting it right. And I know they were putting it on the Schwab thinkorswim, but there you go. So what is this one? HST, it's a host hotels and resorts. Where is the dividend yield? Well, a lot of different ways to do it. Of course, we scanned for it. So you have the dividend yield there. You've got the dividend yield on the trade tab too, right there as well. It's at 4.8% PE ratio, 18.66. A lot of good information right there. There's another one that spiked up. You can see this one too, just reaching above prior highs and beginning to move a little bit. Who knows if it'll continue to break out, but they have been breaking out above those trends. So keep that in mind. All right, let's see. I think we're good on questions, unless my chat is not working. But let's see. Yes, it is working. Great. Okay, sometimes YouTube, it's a little bit slower, but I think we're all good. Any questions on this, folks? There's kind of a lot of information here, but I really wanted to make sure that you really understood this key tool for evaluating REITs right off of thinkorswim right here. Okay, I have this. I'm going to put this search, okay, with the columns in the description box, but I believe it might take, you have to look at it tomorrow. It's going to take about 24 hours for that to update and to be there listed for you. So keep that in mind. All right, as we're looking at that, I did want to just go through though and put just a sample example trade on only about one of these companies that was taking out a prior high. Now, of course, it does have earnings here. Kim, I believe, is one of the biggest real estate or REITs out there. But just a quick note on that. So we're still getting earnings coming ahead. And so anyways, if anybody was going through that entire process and wanted to have a REIT to track, paper trade is a way to do it. So I'm going to go up top. The trade tab, we'll click on the ask price, just put 100 shares into our portfolio. We don't have any REITs that we're tracking right now, but for the sake of example, go ahead and submit that. Markets are closed, but we will be able to track that into the following weeks. Okay, by the way, with any stocks as well, other stocks that you're looking at, always be mindful of risks. If a trend begins to break lower or it breaks a support level, that could be an interesting area too to consider taking shares off the table, which many investors do. But just be mindful of the same risks and the additional risks that we spoke about earlier within our presentation. Let me just highlight those again, because REITs are a little bit different And it says right there, the risks of REITs are similar to those associated with direct ownership of real estate. And that's really a key one. There's some additional points in there as well, as you can see. All right. But with that, folks, I hope you found this informative. That's always the idea. Do me a favor, just in the bottom right-hand corner, smash that subscribe button. That'll allow this kind of content to come back up more frequently for you within our discussions. And that way, in fact, yeah, I think it's like right over, if I just pull this up, bottom right-hand corner of the screen. Well, I guess you can see it on any screen. But hit that subscribe button. Love to have you on board. Folks, if you found this content useful, you like something about it, or if you wanted to provide me some feedback too, any content requests, I'm always open to that. Two simple questions. That's it on that. Let's see. Yeah, there's not, I'm sorry, that's on the survey. Did I see a survey? I don't think there was a survey. Forget it. Yeah, just hit that like button if you did find it useful and something you like. That does help the YouTube algorithm to keep this content coming up more frequently for you folks. But that's what I had for you today. Been great being on with you. And we didn't have one. Okay. Thought I saw one. We're good. Thanks so much. Hey, thank you, Wiley, Jody, BJ. Great to have you all on board. Let's see. Olivia says right here, Michael, Richard, would you mind walking through one more time to, we're out of time, Olivia. I would have loved to have done it. In fact, I'd be more than happy to do that. I could take that question down and hit it next week. Love to have you here, everybody else. And by the way, there's another question too, a comment, topic request from Bernard. So I'll look at that as well. All right, everybody. Today's content was intended for educational information purposes only. Have a great rest of the day. It's been really nice being with you.